Hey, everybody.
Cool.
you won't believe I've got Garrett Madison again. Last time we spoke, he was on Everest and had a fantastic trip up there. And now he's on K2. And, you know, it brings back just wonderful memories, Garrett, of being there with you in 2014. And, you know, you got this old man to the top of the mountain and back down alive. You know, I'm forever in your debt for that. And so now you're back in 2021. It is, I guess it's Thursday, July 15th in Pakistan at 7:30 in the morning. Where are you?
So I'm just down from our K2 base camp at the best place to get a cell signal from the tower, which is in Concordia. And behind me, you can see Broad Peak. So it's a beautiful morning here. We've got some sunshine. It cleared up. It's been snowing the last few days. Probably be a nice day here. And we're just so happy to be here in Pakistan. You know, when we arrived on June 26, all of our logistics went seamlessly, flying out of Islamabad to Skardu, driving by Jeep from Skardu up to Escoli and Jola, trekking into base camp, getting set up here, doing our first rotation. So we're actually on track from our previous expeditions here when we arrived June 18, about 8 days earlier. So we've been very rapid with our logistics and our schedule. And now we've got everything in position on the mountain. We're just waiting for the good weather window, which we hope is going to materialize sometime in late July to give us a chance to go for the summit.
I heard a rumor that there was going to be a very short weather window on the 16th and 17th. Is that too small for you to go for?
Exactly. Today is the start of a short but very good weather window. It's been snowing the last few days and windy, so we don't know how that's affected the mountain up high. Could be some deep accumulation of snow. But our Sherpa team is actually finishing the last of their load carries to Camp 3 and Camp 4 today and tomorrow to get everything in position and ready for us. So when the next weather window materializes, we'll be ready to pull the trigger on our summit attempt.
Yeah, I was thinking that maybe you might be getting in early. And so not doing summiting on my birthday, July 27th, but instead, you know, getting it maybe something earlier, like the 21st or something. So let's back up a little bit. You said that the trek in, I'm sure, was as fantastic as always, you know, with, you know, how many porters did you have carrying this time? 100, 200?
Oh gosh, we had about 150 porters with us on the trek into base camp. And actually, Pakistan's working very hard at developing this area for tourism. I guess in a year or so, the Skardu Airport will be an international airport with direct flights from places like Dubai and Europe, if you can believe that. And they've actually built a road from Escoli now all the way up to the camp we usually trek to on the first night, Jola. And they're continuing to build that road even further to Paiu Camp, which would almost cut the trek in half, if you remember what we did in 2014. So that'll, I think, bring a lot more tourists to the area, especially with the new cell tower they have here at Concordia, working quite well when the power's on. There's a lot of infrastructure improvements they've made, which I think will encourage people to come and visit this beautiful area.
Yeah, you know, that's good news, bad news, in my opinion, because, I mean, I think that trek, I mean, you know me, I'm a big fan. I know you are too, of the trek from the Kumbu, you know, from Lukla up to Everest Base Camp. But that trek along the Concordia Glacier is just, I mean, the Baltero Glacier is just phenomenal. So let's talk a little bit about, I want to talk a little bit about the porters and about the Pakistani climbers that you have with you. The porters are kind of the unsung heroes. You know, they're going along in these canvas shoes and they're carrying, you know, 30, 40 pounds on their back. Talk a little bit about the porters and how they supported getting you guys to base camp.
Well, the porters are just incredible men. You know, they carry heavy loads and they walk so fast with those big loads ahead of us and set up camp ahead of us. They've probably got 20 kg on average, plus their own equipment. And then each night on the trek up the Baltoro, I'm sure you remember this, they build little stone walls out of the rocks on the glacier and then put a tarp over the top and light a fire underneath and make a few chapati tortilla breads for dinner. And they're singing and dancing and just the happiest people you could imagine. So they're the true unsung heroes of the Baltoro, getting us all into base camp. And you know, whether it's snowing or sunny or raining, they're just marching forward. They usually do the trek with us, you know, 5-6 days into base camp, and then they head out in 2 days. So the fact that they can march all the way out about 70 miles in 2 days just speaks to their incredible mental toughness and physical fitness.
And so I know you brought some of your Everest Sherpas over to support your clients, but you also have some Pakistani climbers as well.
Exactly. Yep. We've got four Pakistani climbers, high altitude porters. And we call them Sherpas as well, Pakistani Sherpas, in addition to our Nepal Sherpas. And they all work together on carrying the loads up to the higher camps and fixing the route up to the higher elevations. They all dine together in base camp. So there's just a great sense of camaraderie amongst everyone on the team here, the Nepalis, the Pakistanis, the foreign climbers. We're just so happy to be here. You know, we thought that it wasn't going to be possible to come to Pakistan given the travel restrictions which were imposed back in May. As you probably know, most teams had to cancel plans coming here because of all the uncertainties and challenges. But we just feel so fortunate and lucky that we were able to come and we're able to enjoy this beautiful place with much less people than would normally be here. Last time I was here in 2019, I think there were well over 200 climbers on the K2 permit. Yeah. You probably have the stat on that. What was it, 250 or so?
Yeah, something like that, right. And this year there's like 80 total.
Yeah, and this year there's only, I think, about 80 climbers on the K2 permit. In many weeks, so it just feels like we've got this place all to ourselves, which is such a unique opportunity.
That's pretty amazing because, you know, when we were there in 14, I think we had, it was the 50th anniversary. So there was more people than regular. So talk a little bit about the mountain conditions. I mean, in terms of objective danger, avalanche, you know, snow conditions, how was it? I know you've gone to camp one, two nights, camp two for two nights. Your Sherpas now, you just said, have gone to three and four. So what's the conditions like on the mountain right now?
So right now, the conditions up to camp three are very good. There's more snow than typical for this time of year in the summertime on the Abruzzi Ridge route on camp, the way up to camp one and camp two. That snow is holding the loose rocks in place, covering the rock for the most part. So it makes the cramponing much easier on snow as opposed to rock. And we haven't seen any rockfall yet on the Abruzzi route below camp two. Whereas you recall, typically there's a fair amount of rockfall that's caused by climbers accidentally dislodging stones on the way up or down the ridge. So it's great that there's that extra snow holding all the rocks in place, keeping it much safer from an objective hazard standpoint. Above camp two, Black Pyramid's in great shape. Generally, it's pretty much snow-free except for a few couloirs. And then above the Black Pyramid, up to camp three, we've put it more climbers left towards the ridge line, heading up towards the shoulder at camp four. There's a fair amount of snow at camp three, which is the case. Generally, the winds always come out of the west here. And what that means is snow blows up over the top of the mountain and down onto the bottleneck, the shoulder, and the whole slope that camp three is on. So unfortunately, there's usually a lot of snow there, which is tough to climb through. Hopefully, after this couple days, 2-3 days of good weather we have, 15 through 17, it looks like there's some more snow coming, but also some very strong winds. And I'm hoping those strong winds might blow out all of that snow from camp three above and scour the upper mountain, which was similar to the conditions that NIMS and the winter climbers had when they summited K2 this last winter. So we'll see what happens, but a little bit of wind up there to blow out all that snow would make it a lot easier for us and a lot safer by lessening the risk of an avalanche.
So speaking of the winter expedition, they mixed reports on experiencing a big crevasse between three and four. Have you got any beta on that at all?
So we actually haven't seen that crevasse yet. We're certainly on the lookout for it because we heard a lot about it. But hopefully that crevasse is filled in with snow. When I talked to the winter K2 climbers, Nims and Colin O'Brady and other folks, they said it was so dry on the upper mountain, all kinds of rockfall problems and not much snow at all. Maybe it was just so dry that crevasse was exposed, whereas normally it would be filled in with snow. So I'm hoping that it just happens to be filled in and maybe it doesn't become an issue for us. We haven't heard any reports of it yet up high. And also we're really shifting our route from camp 3 to camp 4, climbers left going up to avoid the broad snow slope that camp 3 is on. You know, when you and I camped at camp 3 back in 2014, we had great conditions.
Yeah.
And it seems like a very stable and safe slope. But in reality, we know from 2013 and also 2016 that that slope can avalanche and that would be catastrophic. So we were really trying to make sure we're playing our cards right and choosing the safest location possible on the way up to camp 3 and camp 4.
So also there's like, as you noted, you know, 80 people, which including, you know, foreigners and support and Pakistanis, that's not that many people really. I mean, traditionally, if you go back 20 years, that's a lot of people, but in modern times, that's not a lot of people for K2. So how are the teams working together? I know that Karakorum Expeditions, Maurice at those guys, they've, you know, they set the ropes on some of the part, other people have set the ropes on others. You know, how's the overall teamwork doing on the mountain these days?
Well, I would say it's good. You know, there's only three big teams that have any kind of manpower or capability to do any rope fixing or serious load carries or work on the route. And then in addition to the three big teams, there's a handful of small teams, which are, right. You know, able to utilize the route that the big teams put in. Right now, you know, our main objective, our focus is K2. And then after we conclude K2, whether we summit or not, we're going to look at Broad Peak. We're all on the K2 and Broad Peak permit. So we've got options, which is great. Right now, because of this weather window, I know Mirza's team is heading for Broad Peak first and then looking at K2 second. We're focused on K2 first. And the Pioneer team also, I think, is focused on K2 first. So we're working on fixing ropes up to camp 3 and camp 4 and getting the oxygen up there and tents and fuel and food and other epi gas, and we'll see what happens. But I think with the teams that are here, we have enough manpower to put the route in if we have good conditions and good weather. That's really the key, as you know, here in the Karakorum. We need good weather and good route conditions in order to have any kind of chance up there. So fingers crossed that we get the opportunity.
So a couple of last things as we wrap up, because I'm really mindful. It looks like it's pretty cold. Is it cold? Are you cold?
No, it's not too bad now. The sun's out and it's warming up here. It was chilly last night. I think it got down to around minus 30. But with the sun out today, it feels quite nice, actually. I know I look like I'm bundled up, but that's just my typical base camp attire.
Yeah, you've got that that mountain hardware down jacket. I can see that right now. So, hey, you know, one thing that obviously is a big objective this year is to try to locate the three missing climbers from the winter expedition. And, you know, and I really hope that, you know, that they're able to find them and to bring some closure to the families. But on a more broad basis, Garrett, you know, you're one of the rare individuals that have been to K2. I mean, how many times have you now been to K2? Six, five?
Well, this is my sixth expedition to K2, and I've been fortunate to summit twice, 2014 with you and then 2018. So I think I'm one of only a couple people who have summited twice.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely true. And then obviously on Everest, you know, you've guided more people, of all the Westerners, not Sherpas, that you have guided more people to the top of Everest than anybody else. So my question is coming back full circle to around the people that are missing on the mountain. And, you know, what would happen if your team came upon you know, some of these people. You know, what's been your experience over all your expeditions in dealing with a tragedy like that? I know it's a sensitive area, and we're, you know, very mindful about the loss to families and to friends and teammates, you know, but it is a reality of climbing these big mountains that deaths do happen. So what is your approach, Garrett, when you come upon, unfortunately, something like that?
Well, generally, we just try to be aware and respectful of the climber or climbers that didn't make it down. This past season on Everest, on Summit Day, we saw a few bodies up there. Probably some well-known instances like Don Cash from Utah and another fellow from Canada, among others. And just try to be respectful. But I did have the opportunity to speak with Ali Sedpara. I had the opportunity to speak with Sajid Sedpara, the son of Ali here. He's with Elia and PK Sherpa just next to our base camp. And we were on the same schedule on our rotation up to Camp 1 and Camp 2. So got to spend some time with them and hear about their plans and their story and, you know, wishing them all the best and whatever we can do to support them. But if we happen to encounter any climbers' bodies that didn't make it down, we'll just be respectful and say some prayers for them. But it's really interesting being here with Elia and Sajid as they go up and try to recover Sajid's father on the mountain if they can find him.
Yeah, just a very difficult situation. And you know, if you can just as you know, I've got visibility or seems like a wider visibility, and so please pass on to them that many people in the mountaineering community are all pulling for them and hoping that they can find closure in that very tragic situation, and we send them our very, very best. So you know, so now as you look forward,
I'll definitely pass that along this morning.
That's great. Thank you. So you've got, you know, a couple more weeks here. Are you going to do another rotation or just kind of hang in base camp and wait for that infamous weather window?
Yeah, no, we're just going to sit tight here and keep ourselves occupied with card games and hikes and movies and just resting up and staying ready for the weather window, which hopefully will materialize sometime in late July.
Yeah, fantastic. I know you have a great base camp set up there and good food with Pakistani cooks this time or Sherpas cooking.
Yeah, we've got some great Pakistani cooks that I've been working with for a number of years, and they just do a phenomenal job of preparing meals for us that are nutritious and healthy. We just can't get enough, and we've got a lot of fresh food. I don't bring too much from the U.S. anymore, just the bacon and the maple syrup and the barbecue sauce. Everything else we get here in Pakistan.
The sweet baby rays. So are porters bringing in?
Exactly.
Are porters bringing in, or are they bringing in fresh produce from time to time?
Yep. Every week we get a resupply of fresh produce and meat and other staples that we need. We can order stuff from Skardu as well. So it's actually become quite easy to get resupplies of things that we need here in base camp. So yeah, we're very well provisioned and looked after and have a comfortable base camp. So we're just happy to be here and enjoying it. And fingers crossed that weather window emerges sometime late in July.
So one last question, because people always ask me this is, you know, did I ever feel safe being in Pakistan? And my two times I was there, I always felt 100% safe, and I felt very welcomed, especially in the Northern Territories. Care to make a comment about how you're feeling relative to safety?
Yeah, you know, I feel very safe here. And Pakistan has done a great job of making tourists and foreigners feel safe visiting their country. Actually, for the first time this year, there were Pakistani tourist police at some of the camps on the trek into base camp. And they approached us several times and asked us, how do we feel? Do we feel safe? we have any concerns. And they just let us know that they're here to look after us and for our safety. And I know the leader of Pakistan, Imran Khan, has done a great job making his country safe and promoting tourism and encouraging the world to come and visit Pakistan, especially this beautiful area here in the North Gilgit-Baltistan. So I feel like Pakistan is really a safe place to visit. Some of the most friendly people in the whole world that I've ever met here.
Yeah.
Very welcoming, warm-hearted, just great, honest, wonderful people. So I feel privileged to be here. And I feel like Pakistan's on a great trajectory moving forward for tourism.
Well, that's great to hear. Because I totally echo everything, all your sentiments that, you know, it's a beautiful country. That part of Pakistan is just awesome. The people are incredible. And I'm so jealous that you're there. Okay, buddy, I'm going to let you go. It's great that this 4G is also working. I mean, my gosh, now you don't have to pay the Thuraya ransom to have a good internet connection.
Right. It's great. It's great to have this internet connection.
One last quick question, because you actually sent me a message from camp too using that 4G, which was amazing. So have you got a chance to talk to the West Ridge guys, Graham and Ian?
No, actually, I have not talked with the West Ridge guys who are here. They're camped a little bit further away from us, kind of out in the middle of the moraine, just down glacier. But I'm going to try to connect with them here in the next few days to find out what their status is and how the progress has been going for them on their new route project that they're exploring. It sounds very, very ambitious and really interesting.
Yeah, I had a great interview with Graham a couple of weeks ago, right before he left. And I'm just so excited for them because, you know, if they can get all the way up that West Ridge, that'll be the first time to complete that whole route. Okay, Garrett. Hey, man, thanks so much for taking the time for walking over from base camp to get this 4G connection. All of our very best to you and the team, to the Sherpas, to the Pakistani, everybody that's there. You know, we're all pulling for you for a safe, safe season. And just looking forward to seeing the results here in a few weeks.
Thank you so much, Alan. Pleasure talking with you. Have a great evening there, and let's keep in touch. All right.